Come on, Putin. I dare you.
One guy died, two guys traumatized. That's the topic of the day.
We can't help ourselves. This is what we do.
Didn't you hear it was the Were Dingo?
Welcome to Unethical Podcast.
Okay,
anyway, now that we're recording, we have 48 minutes until you have to leave, you asshole.
That's it happens.
I'm not leaving my asshole, though. I'm taking my asshole with me. Hey, Iggy, say hi.
Hey.
Popeye.
Oh, my bud.
Aww.
He have
is that
eyes?
A one-eyed cat?
Where are his eyes?
He's a no-eye cat.
So I was right. Aww. He doesn't have eyes.
He's got no eyes.
Good for him. I mean, it's sad that... Has he always been eyeless, or did he get, like, the double enucleation?
So he had a form of cat herpes when he was a baby.
Ew.
And he had it. I mean, he was just, like, a couple weeks old, and they took him out. So he probably doesn't remember much with eyes, but he saw the world for one brief moment. Right, bud?
And all he saw was herpes.
Does he get it out okay?
Oh, well, he runs into things a lot. He loves to run and climb. So as you can imagine, his nose is constantly bruised up, but...
Oh, that's so adorable.
Yeah,
it's cool.
He's a good boy.
It's cool. Aww. I listen to Time Suck, and he always talks about the one-eyed Bojangles, and it just made me think of that. I thought it was a one-eyed cat. I was like, what's his name? Please say Bojangles.
My parents have a one-eyed cat that I adopted nice. For them. Cool. Her name is Leela.
Uh-huh.
Of course it is.
Yeah.
Boom, anyway. Boom. Boom, 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 boom.
All right. Well, it's been a while since we've been together.
It has been too long, in fact.
Mm-hmm. It's been like a month or something like that. And I find the longer we spend apart, the more our episodes derail. So I figured today we'll take it easy. It's also my first time back in the captain's chair since old Chris Chan took over my life.
Took over all our lives. In fact, I still think of Chris Chan too often.
Frequently, mm-hmm. Right? I can't look at Sonic the Hedgehog the same anymore.
Every time I see Sonic, I think of Chris Chan.
Yeah.
I watched the Sonic movie with my kid, like the second one, and I was just kept like, they should just put Sonic Chew in this. They should, because it would be funny. Yeah.
Yep.
No. Chris Chan ruined me.
Yeah, me too. And hopefully everybody who listened to it. It's been like 1,000 people that have listened to it now.
Good. Nice.
Good.
Anyway, I'm just gonna tell some stories. And we can talk about it. So it's going to be nice, short, sweet, easy, low pressure. And I am doing a big deep dive that I'm working on. So I will be back in my classic bug-eyed Celeste fashion very soon. But not today.
That was good.
So now, Richard.
Yes?
You live in Ontario.
I do.
And you used to live in Toronto.
For a long time, yeah.
Do you remember the urban legend of the Leaping Lawyer?
The Leaping Lawyer. No, I've never heard that one.
Okay. Well, the story goes that I have to put on my fucking glasses because I can't read.
Okay. Ooh, that sounds like a deep story. This is going to get interesting. Glasses.
All right.
Oh.
I love urban legends.
Urban legends are fun. I like the movie too.
I love that. A young Jared Leto.
Yeah, I think Jared Leto gets a lot of grief for being weird in real life, but I think in his movies he does well all the time. You know what I mean?
I love Jared Leto, no questions asked.
Except for Joker.
Nope, even like that.
Oh, God. This is the cringiest Joker. The ha-ha-ha and the weird pranks he was doing.
But like the ha-ha-ha and that kind of stuff, that's not Jared Leto's fault. He's not the production designer. Right. He's not putting ha-ha-ha on his face.
He could have said no. No, you're not
I guess so.
Yeah,
you're right.
Dying.
You're right.
I guess so.
His acting was his fault, though, in that movie.
Sure. And I honestly, he's the worst Joker, but I don't think any of the Jokers have been that bad, really.
True.
Like, Jack Nicholson's still the best Joker. Anyways.
Yes.
Thank you. Totally agree.
Agreed. No.
That's okay that you disagree, but you're wrong.
Yeah, you're allowed to. You're wrong. Exactly. But yeah.
Who is it, Joaquin or Heath?
It's Heath Ledger. It is.
I won't fault you for that incorrect opinion, but
whatever.
Nicholson was Heath. I like. Okay, if we're gonna talk about fucking Joker.
Jack Nicholson is the Joker. That's the problem that I have with it. Heath Ledger is fucking adorable, and I love him, and he's super cute. But he played Joker really well. Jack Nicholson is the Joker. He is insane, and he looks like a clown. Sorry, you're not that good of an actor.
Yeah. No, I don't think that Heath Ledger's version of the Joker, like the Chris Nolan version of the Joker, is like too anarchy, not actually thinking things are funny and doing stuff because it's funny. That's what I like about Jack Nicholson's thing. He would say stupid shit because he just thought it was a funny joke, but it would be sinister behind it.
Imagine Jack Nicholson's Joker in the not at all campy Dark Knight series, though.
Yeah. Wouldn't have been as good of a fit.
He'd be a Joker, and that's what he's meant to be.
But I argue that, like, those Dark Knights aren't that good.
They were my favorite.
They're, like, good. They're just not as good as everyone makes them out to be. Chris Nolan's amazing. Don't get me wrong.
A little overrated.
I think it's, yeah. I think it's probably Christian Bale's fault, to be honest.
My dog is named after Harvey Dent because I loved those movies so much.
Good movies. They're not bad movies.
Yeah. No, they're good. They're just not, like, especially the last one, it just got too bad. Like, the second one's good. First one's kind of a snore fest, really. Second one's really good. It's, like, the best one. And then the third one's, like, okay, Catwoman now with this weird bike thing. You're turning into the old Batmans now. You're not even being as dark and fun anymore. It's just, like, unrealistic. I know it's a superhero movie, but the first two were, like, at least, like, believable. Anyways, too much.
We're like fault. I said, derailing. I derailed. Every I time derailed. We don't spend enough time together.
We can't help ourselves. This is what we do.
So all the people that are going to comment, you should redo the episode without all the bullshit. The bullshit is why people come. I'm going to tell you stories you've heard millions of times, but I'm going to make it interesting with what we say to each other.
Favorite Batman?
Oh, that's no one's going to like my answer.
No, it's fine.
Say it.
Well, maybe not. I you know what? I think Pattinson did a really good job, and he might be my new favorite if they do another good movie.
Mm-hmm.
But it's still probably Michael Keaton, just because it's Michael Keaton. I love Michael Keaton a lot. So.
Amazing.
I also didn't hate Ben Affleck. I think he's better than Christian Bale.
100%.
What?
Talking about Batman.
Unconventional opinions, but I agree with them.
I watch a lot of movies, and I just, some stuff, it has a thing to it that you can't explain. And the original 89 Batman has that. It's, like, amazing. Just the whole thing.
Which one's the 89?
That's the one with Joker and, like, Tim Burton. Michael Keaton, yeah.
Not my favorite Batman. I liked Val Kilmer, actually, a lot.
I love that movie. It's so bad, but I love it. I love that one.
Yeah.
It's, like, it gives me, like, 1990s Ninja Turtle vibes.
It's better than... It's better than, like, what's his name? Fucking Clooney.
George Clooney.
Yeah, Clooney as Batman was terrible. The worst.
I forget that movie Iceman. Exists. Oh, God. So bad.
Okay, anyway. The Leaping Lawyer. Let's talk about it. The story goes that a lawyer in downtown Toronto had a group of law students come to see what his firm has to offer for when they graduated. The confident and boisterous lawyer's favorite party trick around the office was to throw his entire body against the 24th floor window of the Toronto Dominion Bank Tower, only to bounce off of it safe and sound to demonstrate the incredible tensile strength of the glass.
Oh, good.
So this was something he'd been doing for years when showing people around the office. And during this reception held at the office on July 9th, 1993, something a little different happened. As he showed them around, he wanted to give them his little show, and he hurled himself at the window. And as he predicted, he bounced off and landed safely. As the gasps settled and the back slaps commenced, he decides to do it again for good measure while talking about how incredibly strong these windows are. But this time, something happened that he didn't expect.
God.
Within seconds, he was crumpled, lifeless, 24 stories below. Glass was strewn around the street around him, but it wasn't the glass breaking that led to the tragic nosedive. Instead, the repeated forceful impacts had loosened the glass from its frame, and this time the glass simply popped out of the frame and accompanied the man down to his death, shattering on impact.
Well, I was gonna say, you can only hit something a number amount of times before it's gonna break. Should have chosen a different window, mate.
He didn't even break the glass, though. That's awesome. I thought that's where that was going. He just popped the glass out of the... you fucking
did
idiot.
Did he get a Darwin Award? I feel like I heard him getting one.
He did. He did indeed. Yes. This popular Toronto myth is, in fact, not a myth at all. The lawyer's name was Gary Hoy. He was well-educated, very successful, and a large part of his success could be attributed to his confidence and confrontational spirit. But too bad being educated and smart doesn't mean you're not a total fucking idiot.
So did these people that, like, all the students just watched him die. That's amazing. And they just, like, did they talk about it? Like, does any of the students have any accounts? I love it. I'd love to talk to some of them.
Yeah, they must. Get them on a podcast, man.
I'm sure they remember it. This was 1993, though, so this didn't get as big as you would imagine something like that would get now.
Oh yeah, nowadays there'd be everyone videotaping it.
This was literally a lot of people believe that this is just an urban legend in Toronto. Most people don't even know that this actually happened. His name, Gary Hoy.
Or I mean, you said it was the legend of the
leaping lawyer.
Oh, leaping. It's a bouncy lawyer.
Bouncy lawyer.
I guess I'm not bouncy.
That might be the second biggest boner of a suicide out of a building. The other one's the one like at the Cecil Hotel where she actually jumped out and killed someone on the ground. Like she hit someone that she hit. That's another big boner one. Like, fuck, I just wanted to kill myself. Like she probably felt bad for that 1 second. You know what I mean? Move. No.
That would be an epic way to kill yourself. Like fool everybody and then loosen the pains of the frame of the glass and like pretend you fell out.
That's true. So you traumatize an entire room full of people at the same time. Yeah,
go out like a legend.
Your 5-year plan to kill yourself, you just have it like Mr. Hoy, good, rest in peace, buddy. Rest in whatever Jesus. You left. Yeah, I don't know how what you ended up like, but rest in pancake. I don't know.
Yeah, rest in paste, more like.
Ew.
The long way to fall.
Yeah, no that thanks. Is. Not my favorite way to die. I don't think I would want to die that way, falling like that.
Honestly, seems. I mean, the falling part would be scary, but I feel like it'd be over pretty quick.
Once you probably get a crazy adrenaline rush from the fall.
Yeah, I guess so.
Nice little high right before you hit the ground.
It keeps your organs running for quite a while afterwards. Like if someone has it's the same with like a car crash and stuff. If you have a hard impact and your body's pumping full of adrenaline, that's why you bleed out so fast, because your body, your heart and everything is working at full speed. So it's like, you don't,
I think if you're a pancake though, how much left of the organs to keep running? Yeah,
he was for sure killed on impact. He
100%.
He didn't leave 100%. A pretty corpse.
No. Over 23,
24. 24 stories. Ooh. He fell.
Yeah.
It's a long way. Do you know where the Toronto Dominion Tower is?
I do. Yeah. It's right on Bay Street, I believe.
It's big. Big boy.
Yeah. Big boy. Yeah. No, that must have been a. See, that's you say you get an adrenaline rush and then you just like a high. Imagine you like the last second, you're like, I don't want to die. You know, like, I'm so high right now. I didn't realize it could be this good.
I mean, a lot of suicide jumpers, the ones that survive, they've said that, right? The suicide jumpers, they'll say that they regret it like halfway down.
Yeah.
It's like, oof.
I think in episode 3, I can't remember, one of the episodes we played that poem from BoJack Horseman about
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Jumping?
Yes.
Mm. Yeah. I always think of that now when I think about, like, jumping suicides. The view from halfway down.
Yeah, this guy didn't even mean to, though. So it'd be pure terror, I think.
Yeah, this was not intentional at all. He thought he'd bounce off fine. And he did not, unfortunately.
Man. Well, he gets Darwin, and I'm giving him a unethical dumb dumb award. I don't know. I gotta think of a good one to give him. He gets two dumbs up.
We've got a few of them. So
or a dumb down, I guess. A dumb real down. I fast quickly down. Dumb. I don't know what terminal velocity is, but that many dumbs down.
Yeah.
Terminal. Definitely terminal velocity.
As you guys have blown the wad on several times, before the times of the True Crime Comedy Podcast and after the time of the Stockades, if you wanted to cackle at the misfortune of others with your friends, you would sit around and you would read the Darwin Awards. Yeah. So we're going to take it back to the roots of True Crime Comedy Podcasting with some of my favorite tales of people getting themselves killed. And as a bonus, these stories always have very few details. So we can jam-pack a whole lot of fun into a short format.
That's good.
So
we can make it up.
Welcome to the Podwin Awards.
Speculate. Yeah, the Podwin Awards. I like that.
Podwin. Two dumbs way up. Okay, so let's start with one of my favorites. This one gives me like major warm fuzzies. 35-year-old Jose Luis Ochoa was your run-of-the-mill rapscallion in California. His favorite pastimes included raising gamecocks, training fighting animals, and being a piece of shit. He used these skills in the despicable underworld of cockfighting, which he frequently attended and participated in. Not exclusively, though. Every fight he was ever in was a cockfight. So one evening, he limps into a hospital with a sharp force injury on his right calf, and it was determined that he had been stabbed 2 hours earlier. And Jose died in the hospital from his injury. Now, it's unclear if it was caused by his delay in getting treatment or some kind of an underlying condition, but the important thing is that he did die. Thank goodness.
Good.
So when police went to investigate the scene of the stabbing, they found his killer was there and unfortunately already dead. His killer was identified as a trained rooster who specialized in knife fighting. The owner of the rooster tied knives to its legs to make it a more dangerous fighter, and during the fight, the rooster went wild and stabbed Jose with its knife legs.
Oh my God. I knew they did this at cockfights. I knew they tied knives, but I never knew it took down a man. That's amazing, you piece of shit. You deserve it too, so that's fantastic.
From they stabbed him in the calf and it killed him?
Damn. He didn't get treatment for 2 hours, so it could have been something that got in the wound, an underlying condition, just that he bled out. Maybe he was drunk as a fucking skunk.
Isn't there a big ass artery? Yeah, I was going to say there's a big ass artery that runs through your leg, right?
Not your calf.
Must be something in there.
Runs down the middle of your leg.
Huh.
So to get to stab the back of the calf, you're just hitting pure muscle pretty much. But if you didn't get it treated for 2 hours and it was really deep, then.
I'm losing blood here. I should go to the hospital. But he still has the knives on his hands. I must stop him. He will kill more. Maybe you see.
He will kill again.
He's got the taste of human blood on him. He's ready to kill more. My kids are in the other room.
Oh, fuck.
Cockfighting. What a weird thing to do.
It is so weird.
So weird. So weird.
Like, I don't know. It's kind of a fun, like... Like, I understand the, because they'll kill each other, they'll maul each other right up. I understand, like, the gladiatorial thing. It's just, like, there's other animals that do that are more fun than a fucking big chicken. You know what I mean? Like, why are we watching the big chicken? Get some fucking dogs or whatever. Like, I get.
Yeah, no, I'm very
I don't want to do any of it.
What you're saying right now? No, don't let any animals fight each other for your entertainment.
Okay, do you guys remember, this is a throwback. It was probably early 2000s, and there were these viral clips called like Japanese bug fights, and they would have like a tarantula versus a praying mantis or some shit like that. And you felt so bad watching it, but it was like, I mean, I remember when I was a teenager, it was like, oh my God, yes, there's a new Japanese bug fight thing.
Bugs are different. Bugs don't have feelings.
I get the They're the appeal. So cool,
hey, though. Have you not watched Bug's Life?
Yeah, true. Checkmate.
I'm sorry, I'm not going to buy into your propaganda. Settle down.
Or Ants with Woody Allen?
No.
Is that Woody
Allen? That movie freaked me the fuck out.
It is Woody Allen.
The terrifying movie.
Bug's Life. Bug's Life is better.
Yeah, for sure. And bees, don't even get me started on that bee movie. Get the fuck
out of here. Oh god, I hate that film.
I love Jerry Seinfeld, but get the fuck out of here, Jerry. Yeah, no, I'm glad that that chicken or that rooster got him. That's fucking awesome. Yeah. That makes my day. That's amazing.
Absolute hero.
Yeah, that chicken, it gets Bush of the Week. And I know chickens just get feathers so far. Maybe there's a bigger bush this time.
No, Bush of the Week on that rooster for sure.
Yeah, that rooster gets Bush of the Week for sure.
Jose's death actually led to stricter enforcement of laws banning cockfights in California, so that's good.
Oh, good.
Good.
I mean, it sucks that it's in his honor or whatever, but
did they name the law after him? Because every time they name a law after someone, it's really sad.
So they already had a law, it just wasn't strictly enforced. They would just basically fine you if they found you training fighting animals, but they started getting real strict about that after he died.
Good. Yeah, rooster's fighting's weird. Weird one.
I don't get it. I don't get why you would want to watch anything kill each other.
Yeah, it's just primalness.
Except, people make sense.
Okay.
Well, as long as you can consent to it, you know.
That's called Fight Club.
Well, or you're paying your debt to society. Like you want criminals fight each other.
You want criminals to fight with a criminal fight
club? Bring back gladiators, or like Hunger Games.
Oh, I'm actually in because I just thought about tying knives to prisoners' hands, and that would get real violent real quick, and that would be kind of cool. Yeah.
Like, no, like not Edward knives, Scissorhands. Just like tie something like that just does minor damage.
Rubber chickens.
Something like that. Give them like very non-damaging weapons to fight with and see how long it takes for them to kill each other.
Make an egg and
rubber chickens, so they also make music as they're...
Edward 40 Hands, did you guys ever play that?
No. Oh, that's where they duct tape a whole...
You duct tape 40 to 40 your hands? Beers to your hands?
Yeah.
You gotta finish them?
Yeah.
You fight somebody.
Yeah.
I didn't know that has fighting at the end of it. That makes
sense. No, that's my addition. We'll do
that. I gotcha.
Okay. Yeah, so that's one of my favorite ones. But our next story takes place in the beautiful Italian Alps. This is a fun one. 46-year-old David Monk was on a ski trip with some friends when they decided it would be a good idea to do some sledding instead of skiing. One problem, the boys didn't have a sled.
Oh, no.
It's unclear which of these brilliant men came up with this idea, but they decided that since they were under cover of darkness and the ski lifts were closed, they would remove the thick mattress-sized crash pad from around one of the support poles of the ski lift, and they would use that to sled down the hill. It was made of rubber. I have no doubt it absolutely fucking ripped down the snowy peaks, but with sick rips comes even sicker crashes. David Monk was fatally injured when the pad crashed full speed into the very same support pole they had removed it from.
I feel like this has something to do with Edward 40 Hands. You know what I mean? Like, I feel like they were playing Edward 40 Hands before this happened. This is not a sober day. No. Oh my God.
One of his friends was hospitalized with minor injuries. The other one was uninjured. Police were pressured to investigate and issue criminal charges against the surviving friends and or the resort for allowing the guests to have free rein at night to kill themselves.
Oh, I can't imagine trying to do CPR on your buddy with fucking 240s stuck to your hands. You know what I mean? Like,
or steer a sled. Which
exactly.
Steer.
Oh my God. Oh, wow.
So you said they tried to sue the ski lodge?
Mm-hmm. The investigation was closed very quickly and no one was found to be at fault.
Yeah, like, you can't stop drunken idiots from doing things. Like, you could try, you could put a fence up, like...
They tried to sue the glass company for the leaping lawyer as well, but they were like...
Oh, my God.
Nowhere in our manufacturing does it say that it can withstand the weight of a 160-pound man flinging himself at it repeatedly, so...
Oh, my God. What makes you think... Anyways, cool. Like, you ever see someone... Sorry, I'm back on that thing, but you ever see someone, like, show you something? Like, well, look what I could do, and then it's something not cool, and you're like, okay. Like, do you think all these guys are impressed?
Yeah.
I have a 5-year-old. I live it every day. Mama, watch this.
Yeah, and they do like a fucking jump spin and you're like, good job.
Yeah. And you have to be excited about it because you crush their little dreams.
Oh, otherwise. No, for sure. Because so you... to them, it's super exciting. But
watch I've my done... front flip. That was a somersault. No, it was a front flip. Definitely a somersault.
All right, Naruto, chill out. Like,
yeah, watch me do a roly-poly. He like falls to the side and he's like, I'm like, that was amazing, Gabe.
Do you ever say that kind of sucks? Like just once. Like, that wasn't cool.
Sometimes you just gotta think it, you know? Like you gotta you resist the urge so much. I don't think I've ever told them it sucks, but it has sometimes.
Yeah. I for sure
have. I have cats, I guess.
I do very often as he's walking away from me, give him the finger in the back of the head.
But back to these like sledders, if you ever I've done this before where you get like hammered or whatever and you go like, let's have an adventure, and you do something and you look back like the next day or even like weeks or years later and you go like, we probably should have died. So like that one, I kind of feel like it's not really, I think all of us could get a Darwin, we just aren't lucky enough not to, you know, that's just a bad luck.
Yeah,
that's true. They all died.
One guy, right?
Just one guy died. One guy was injured, another guy was fine.
Yeah. Ooh. Survival. One guy died, two guys traumatized. That's not that big of a deal.
That's just a good drunk story.
Honestly, that sounds fun. What they were doing, that sounds actually kind of fun. If I'm to be honest.
It does, a little bit.
The only part that's not fun is walking up that hill without the goddamn chairlift. God damn it. No. And with beer cans taped to your hand? Like, fuck no.
I like that that's an official part of the story.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah. And listen to future episodes because I guarantee you we'll talk about it again.
Okay. I want to take a little private dicks break here because I came across this one and I was trying to figure out how I could make it work and I can't. So I want you guys to solve a little mystery for me.
Oh, good.
TZ, you were once an honorary dick and we've got Richard here with us. So between the two of you, I think that you guys can solve this mystery.
Christy's been a dick before. Christy's brought me a case and helped me solve it.
I'm the Aussie dick.
She's the clit dick.
Oh, if only you knew.
It's like a thumb. Anyways.
Yes.
All right. Private dick / clits. I will not be giving you any contacts, but I will answer questions and brutally shut you down when you're wrong. In November of 2004, 21-year-old Philip Quinn was killed when a shard of glass from his lava lamp penetrated his heart. Now, the lava lamp exploded after he heated the contents on the stove.
No.
Now, boys, why did he do that?
I'll start. Okay. I think that he thought the inside would be delicious. So he wanted to like warm it up to eat it, to get in there somehow.
But heat is what makes the shit move around. He can heat it up just by turning it on.
Okay, fuck, I've got it wrong. You guys try.
Probably look really cool. Like it already looks pretty cool. Even hotter. Double hot. The coolness.
Yeah. So it went faster?
Just whatever. Like, just get all that lava going.
The hotter it gets, the cooler it gets.
The cooler it gets. Not cooler temperature-wise, but cooler looking. That'd be my thought. I might try that.
Okay, that was my next question was, is that enough for you to try heating a lava lamp on the stove?
I put it in the microwave.
You... should not have made it to adulthood. Christy, do you have
I don't know, but there's in the bottom of a lava lamp there's like a metal ring because that's what heats up, and then
isn't it like egg-shaped, kind of like, isn't it hard to even stand up on its own without like the case of,
I think it was on its side, but I'm not sure. I think it was on its side
because that's why I wouldn't do it. That's why I would not do it, because it wouldn't be easy. Be like, if it was easy and you could like sit it there and turn it up, I would probably be like, well, it might be cool, let's see if it crank up the heat here.
Just put it in a pot like spaghetti.
Yeah, yeah. I'm gonna soften this noodle.
Did you ever see that video of the guy who puts the it's like some young kid, he puts a glow stick in the microwave. He Ooh. Takes it out and shakes it, and it explodes in his eyes. Starts screaming. His dad comes in. What the fuck did you do, you idiot? I told you not to do that.
I've got glow stick juice in my eye once. It fucking hurts.
Molten? Have you gotten molten glow stick yeah, juice in your eyes?
No. Not hot glow stick juice. Just normal juice. Yeah, I don't know. Was he fucking high on mushrooms or something?
No.
And thought that if he heated it up enough, he would like morph into it and become part of the lava lamp. Mm. I don't know.
No drugs, no alcohol.
Oh.
Just a soft noodle.
He did live in a trailer, so I initially assumed meth. But
oh.
No drugs, no alcohol.
How old was he, you said?
21.
It's about the right age to do something like that.
Yeah.
Okay, so you're all just going with just cuz.
Maybe cooking. He was trying to cook something with it.
Right.
Like make a pizza sauce.
Oh, yeah. Maybe he'd run out. Dipping it was a sauce. Red lava lamp. Yeah.
Yeah.
Kind of think, I thought that we got kind of confirmation that he did it to make the thing go faster or cooler. Make it cooler.
I mean, sure, that I guess, but I feel like that wouldn't be something you do by yourself if you're not high. Why would you care?
There's a lot of dumb people out there, Celeste. Like, there's a lot of people doing a lot of dumb shit by themselves all the time, you know?
But why not just, like, hook up with a three or something like that? Like, why do you have to heat lava lamps?
No, I don't get it. That's why I'm trying to, like, I thought maybe I went with the food thing. Like, maybe you want to eat it because people eat stupid shit, too. But I don't know. I don't know why you'd heat that up. To, like, impress your girlfriend? She's coming over. Look, I'm going to have a hot lava lamp.
Look at my speedy lava lamp.
Extra.
I think it was his girlfriend that found him, but it wasn't until like the next morning.
Oh, poor thing.
So he had a girlfriend. So yeah. He could have been doing something like hanging out with his girlfriend, but he did this. Okay. I thought for sure this was a no girlfriend thing.
No, he had a girlfriend. Yeah, he did.
Sorry, honey. I can't come over tonight. I've got some serious business to attend to.
Doing some science.
He's got one of those like glasses that come down with one of them that's a little bit closer, you know. I'm doing some real good, real precise work tonight, honey.
Oh, God.
I don't think we've dicked this one.
Yeah, no, we could just pretend it was a were-dingo. He thought there was a were-dingo in there, and then it's fully dicked. Like, it's been fully private dicked.
Right, okay, so were-dingos, we're going to go with that. Cool.
Yeah, okay.
Were-dingos is why he heaped the lava lamp on the stove and killed himself. Mm-hmm. Although, it was supposed to penetrate the were-dingo's heart. But it penetrated his. Yeah. Unless he was the were-dingo and it was a trap set by someone else.
Yeah. RJ was in his house heating a lava lamp, waiting for a goddamn dingo to show up. He finally tracked down the goddamn.
With his Dr. Monocle on.
He's like, with these glasses, I'm the only one who's safe in this room. There you go. We private dicked it. That sounds about as ridiculous as any private dicks.
RJ killed Philip Quinn in 2004. All right.
Yeah. He's a were-dingo.
Because he was a were-dingo. Yeah.
Because he was a were-dingo. Okay. Yeah. Cool. We should thank RJ for his service.
Thanks, RJ.
Amazing.
See that little 11-year-old, 12-year-old RJ. Good for him. Okay. This one is a little bit sad, but I also have zero empathy.
Why did he do it?
I don't know. I don't know. Oh, man. No one knows.
It's speculation. Mystery. Speculation. Speculation. Yeah.
Didn't you hear it was the were-dingo?
Yeah. We already figured out why he did it.
Well, we're the first people to actually have an answer because his family doesn't know. His girlfriend didn't know. Nobody knew. Everyone was like, he was like a smart guy. I don't know why he would do this. But it was because RJ did it.
Oh, that's okay. Amazing.
I'll just have to reconcile myself.
Ask RJ.
Imagine that crime scene, though. You walk in and just, like, goop from a lava lamp scrolling down the fucking side of the stove, and the guy just dead with a fucking bunch of blood pooling up with a giant chunk of a... Like, what do you even think? Were-dingo. That's what I'm saying. Like,
that's what I would think.
Yeah.
Oh, fuck. Must have been going real fast to get through those ribs, too. Jesus.
Yeah.
All right.
Okay.
I'm disappointed. Move on.
Okay. So, like I said, this one's a little sad, but I also have no empathy for drunk driving, so I am fine with it. Summer of 2004, two friends, John Hutcherson, 21, and Francis Brome, 23, were absolutely loaded driving home from the bar. And John was driving, and Francis was hanging out the passenger window, vomiting along the road.
Never done that before.
I've puked outside of a moving vehicle before, and it was bad. We were, like, in a rush, and I was super sick. And I was just, I'm a loud puker, too. I'm like, blah, 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 up the side.
I'm kidding. I've done it so many times. Oh, okay, good.
But we went, we looked out the back, and, like, the entire car was just
down covered. The car.
Yeah, it was bad. And I was so sick, and it was my friend's car, and he was driving, like, and we went to the gas station, and I was, I'll clean it, man. I just remember being so sick, shame cleaning the side of his fucking truck.
That's commendable.
Yeah. I was almost home. Oh. I knew I was almost there. I didn't want the stomach acids to peel his paint on his truck, because that was his concern. Your stomach acids are going to peel my paint on my truck. Like, okay, man, I got you.
You take the little squeegee thing.
Yeah, it was bad.
Amazing.
I've never done that, you delinquents.
Oh, I wasn't even drinking that time. I was just sick.
You ever puke in a cab?
No. I did get kicked out of a cab because he thought I would puke, and I was like, vomit three since 93, bitch.
Did he let you stay?
No. Although that might be because I called him a bitch.
I've been kicked out of many cabs back in my drinking days. I would always try to get him to bring me to Taco Bell and then buy him something in the drive-thru. And they usually wouldn't want anything, and to get an argument with them about, no, I'm going to buy you Taco Bell.
Fuck you, man. Take my taco.
And then they usually get very upset. It was usually be a Middle Eastern guy.
Don't they not eat beef?
Oh, that's probably why they were
offended. Because I imagine Taco Bell is not halal.
No.
Oh, that's nice.
Okay. So they're driving. Francis is throwing up all over the side of the road, and I guess the side of the car, I'm learning. Okay, so suddenly John veers off the road, and it was no longer vomit spewing from Francis's throat. It was blood. When John had gone off the road at an unknown but presumably ridiculously fast speed, Francis was decapitated by a telephone support wire. The force was enough that John was found with Francis's blood all over him, though Francis's body remained leaning out the passenger side window.
Oh, no.
John then drove the remaining 12 miles home, where he got out of the car, went inside, and went to bed. And Francis's headless body remained in the truck until it was discovered the next morning by a man and his baby daughter.
Oh.
Dude, come on up. Let's go to bed. You're tripping me out back there with no head. Fuck you then. You stay in the car. I'm going to bed.
Did this inspire the Hereditary scene with Millie Shapiro where she...
I didn't see Hereditary.
It's wicked. You're missing out.
It's insane.
It's so good. I'm going to say, I hope so, because it's worth something then. And you think this is sadder than the other ones? Like, they're all sad. Like, a guy fucking jumping out of a window to his death. That's sad, too. Like,
yeah, but Francis wasn't. I mean, he was kind of being a moron. But, like, if it was just Francis, he probably wouldn't be dead. So, I mean, it's John. If John had died, I wouldn't think it was sad. Francis is a little sad. But, again, they're also both fully loaded. And they're driving. So, I don't really feel that bad.
That's what I was going to say. You got in a car with a drunk driver and didn't stop him or anything. Being hammered or not, you're kind of you fucked up too, man. You know?
Yeah, that's kind of where I'm at.
You kind of deserve it. So I think they're equally sad. This is actually humorous, less like the fucking rooster who had to fight for his life to save his get out of there is like more sad, you know, that he got shit tied to him than that. So,
I agree. Reports stated that John seemed very remorseful when he was awoken by the police the next morning, covered in blood and smelling like booze. And he was sentenced to 5 years in prison for a multitude of charges, including driving under the influence and vehicular manslaughter. But the leniency of the sentence largely was a result of Francis's family asking that he serve no jail time, as the two had been very close friends since preschool.
Aww.
Oh, good.
I don't know. It got sadder now.
Well, sad. I guess so. But I mean, Francis doesn't sound too smart. He's 2 years older and in preschool with this guy. So he probably already had a lot of close decapitations happen to him in the past. They were probably just used to it at this point.
And what were they doing drinking and driving in preschool?
Yeah, exactly.
That's way too young.
That's way too young to be drinking and driving.
Yeah.
Either or both.
That's, I don't, like, at some point, though, even if the victim's family are like, yeah, just don't give him any time, you still give him, like, 5 years. I feel like that guy's not, maybe, I don't think, where is this, America? In the U.S. somewhere?
Illinois, I believe.
Yeah, I don't feel like he's getting rehabbed for that 5 years. You know what I mean? I feel like he's starting a new habit, probably in jail.
Oh, definitely in America, too. We don't rehab people. We turn them into criminals.
Is it America? Because now he's coming out stealing cars and driving them drunk.
Probably a drug addiction and
yeah,
unhireable. Yeah.
No, it wasn't Illinois. It was Kentucky.
Oh, much better.
Oh, oh dear.
Getting lucky in Kentucky. Getting unlucky.
This one's unlucky in Kentucky, but yes, I see what you're doing there.
Well, only 5 years, though. That's kind of lucky.
Oh, yeah, he got lucky. I've been talking about Francis got very unlucky.
Yeah.
You think the last couple seconds of falling to your death is shitty? The last couple seconds while your head is off watching your body be apart from it is probably more fucked up.
At the end of a trail of vomit like a mile long.
Man, at least he was drunk.
Yeah, exactly.
No. All right. TZ, it's 5 minutes too.
Yeah, I have 5 minutes. Should I say sayonara?
You should stay and tell your dad to go fuck himself.
Yeah, okay. Then I'll end up in one of these stories, man. Yeah. Well, thank you guys for having me on. This was a lot of fun.
Yeah, no problem.
Yeah. Do it again. Anytime.
Well, yeah, man. I'm still patiently awaiting a new episode from you. So,
yes. I'll also be working on that late tonight.
I don't want to pressure you, but hurry up. I'm just kidding.
It's going to be, have you heard of the Daniel Shaver case?
Shaver. Mm-hmm. Is that the guy that you told me about this already? Is that the guy?
I might have told you. Yeah.
Yeah. That's the guy who got shot in the hotel room by the cops when they're looking for somebody else. Yeah.
Yeah.
Sad one.
It's going to be like 3 hours too. It's going to be our longest episode.
Cool. So. I'm excited. Man. Yeah, man.
Thank you, everybody.
Thanks love for coming. Nice to meet you.
Yeah. And I'll see you guys soon.
Yeah, man. Soon enough. At least on the internet.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. See you guys. Brother.
Bye. Talk to you later.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Sorry, TZ had to leave. It's very sorry, but... But we have more fucking, what was this called? Podwin Awards. Yeah, we got more Podwin Awards to give out here.
We do. We've got some more.
The show must go on.
Okay, so this one's actually just funny. In 2017, a Russian man named Alexander Chechik was found in his car with his lower body completely blown apart.
That is funny.
Yeah, it is, right? It's funny.
The end.
Next!
Police discovered shrapnel in the vehicle remaining from a hand grenade. And initially, the police believed that someone had thrown the grenade into the car and murdered him.
He wasn't hooping a grenade.
He wasn't what?
Hooping a grenade, was he?
Like, what does that mean? Putting his dick in one?
Putting it up his ass.
Oh, no. I don't think
okay.
So.
Anyway, sorry, keep going. I just thought maybe he was using it as a pleasure device.
I don't know. How could they tell if he was blown apart?
That's true.
And he might have.
Okay.
But possibly. Okay. Why is it called hooping?
I don't know. It's like a prison term. It's like when you hoop drugs into prison. That's like when you put it in a condom and then like hoop it. I guess because your butthole is kind of like the net, you know, shooting into the hoop.
That seems a little bit too complicated. Okay. So, police believe that someone had murdered him, like I said. But when they announce the discovery, friends came to the police and told them that they had received texts and a photo from Alex the previous day. And one of the photos was Alex holding the grenade. And for good measure, he had removed the pin and placed it on the car seat behind it.
The car seat?
Not like a child's car seat, like the seat.
Oh, I thought he was like, my kid's in it. My kid's in daycare right now, guys. Look what I got. Because that would be 3 dumbs up. So far, it's only 2 dumbs up. Okay, so he's sending his friends pictures of this. Good.
Yeah, so Alex had apparently started dabbling in the weapons trade. Mm. And so he's trying to show his friends how cool he is. And it's unclear exactly how he came to explode. But the texts that he sent would reveal that he believed grades don't explode unless they're thrown. And based on the gnarly crime scene photos, I think that he just gently put it in his lap while he was texting or trying to get the pin to put it back in or something.
Oh my God. If you're going to be like a weapons dealer, you should probably know how the weapons work. It's like being like a knife salesman and being like, knives only cut if you chop, you know?
That's the title of the episode. It's only cut if you chop.
It's like, it's stupid. Like, you should probably know how your fucking shit, anything you're selling, I don't care what it is, you should know how it works. Yep. And then you can sell it. Yep. Don't, you got to throw a grenade. That's the dumbest, most asinine thing. What does this happen in 1974? When does this happen? Nobody's played a video game.
2017. Like
if you pull a pin in a grenade in like Modern Warfare or something and don't throw it, you could blow up. Like, you know this. If you played a game, a video game once. Wow. Okay. Good job. Good job, idiot.
Alex.
I hope he probably hooped it. He's like, tell that you throw it. Tell you throw it, it's just a sex toy. Watch. And that was the picture he's about to press send on.
Two grenades way up my ass. Yeah.
Doesn't even hurt. Doesn't even feel like it's gonna explode, guys. There's no countdown. It's not gonna explode.
Okay. I think we've got 2 more.
Nice. I'm having a lot of fun with this, by the way.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay. 2 more. So in 2009, Vladimir Likanos killed himself via bubblegum.
Oh, okay. Did he swallow it? Because usually that's what my parents used to tell me. It's gonna like, did he swallow lots of bubblegum? Then you just die, apparently.
No.
It's bad for you. Okay. No.
Yeah, my parents would say it would get stuck around my heart.
Yeah.
Oh, did not happen. Die.
Okay. Thank God. I swallowed gum today.
So one evening, he was tinkering with his computer when his mother heard a loud explosion. She came running and found Vlad on the ground, deceased, with his jaw completely blown off. What? The piece of gum that Vlad had been chewing was also found. The police tested the gum and discovered that it had traces of an unidentified chemical explosive that was said to be 4 times as powerful as TNT.
Wait, he's found C4? Shit. He was eating C4? I didn't know dentine ice C4 was a thing.
Well, who would do this to this young man's gum?
The fucking guy who shoved the grenade up his ass. I don't really know. I'm not.
The were-dingo.
Was not, in fact, the were-dingo or the guy with the grenade up his ass or RJ this time. It was, in fact, Vlad himself that did this to his gum.
Oh, my God.
Was this like there's easier ways to kill yourself, man? Was he trying to commit suicide?
It was not a suicide attempt. I will tell you. So, according to friends and family, Vlad was a little genius from childhood that liked science and making firecrackers. They also said that Vlad chewed gum all the time. And that Vlad liked to dip his gum in citric acid to give it a sour taste. The last piece of the puzzle, Vlad was a chemistry student at the Kiev Polytechnic Institute and had access to various chemicals. Shattered around the apartment, police found remnants of citric acid, as well as remnants of this unknown explosive. So they were able to put together that as Vlad was tinkering on his computer, he went to dip his gum in citric acid as usual, but he had accidentally dipped it in the identical container of this unidentified explosive. And then either his saliva mixing with it or the pressure of him chewing caused the explosion that killed him.
Oh my God. This doesn't sound like a very good chemist. If you just keep all your shit, hey, usually these guys are, if you're a big scientist like that, you're going to put away your shit. You're going to clean up your work area. You know what I mean? That's just what I think, unless he was working on some sort of explosive at the same time. But then you dipped it in like the oopsie daisy, I got explosives fucking pile on my desk. I don't fucking, you're a terrible scientist, Vlad.
Police were quoted to say, quote, anyone could have mixed them up. And you can quote me on this, only a fucking idiot would store them right next to each other when you're eating
exactly.
one.
Exactly.
They're both sitting next to each other in his mom's fucking Tupperware containers. He's just like.
Is this Ukraine or how long ago? Is this Ukraine or Russia?
This is
or
Kiev?
Like USSR?
This is Kiev. And then he's Ukrainian.
So, yeah, it depends though what year.
2009.
Oh, okay, so yeah, this is Ukraine then, because like before 1991, it would have been USSR, right? But that would have changed my opinion on it because I like Ukrainians and I don't like Russians right now. So fuck Russia.
yeah, shove grenades up your ass, Russians.
Stupid Russians. Yeah, fucking, they all are. They don't. Hey, Russia, guess what? If you pull the pin on a grenade, it doesn't explode unless you throw it.
Until do it right throw now. It, yeah.
Yeah, do it right now, you fucking douchebag.
Test the theory. Go on.
Test it. Yeah. Hope you're listening to this on the front lines, you fucks.
Come on, Putin. I dare you.
Yeah. Wouldn't that be hilarious? Putin's like at like a speech, just pulls a trip in. He's just like, see, they don't, stupid American, they don't throw like boom. And he just explodes with a shirt off on TV. Oh, God, that'd be awesome. Oh, my God,
it'd be so good.
Piece that would shit. Be great. I'm going to dream about that tonight.
Yeah, that's a fucking piece of fan art we need to see.
I'll get Bo right on it.
This fucking Ukrainian. This guy blowing himself up. I honestly have zero sympathy for that. I think that's stupid.
Yeah.
It's kind of what we do need to do, if this is 2009, well, and I think to help this out, and I think this is a good ethical plan on unethical, I think we should actually get the gum companies to send them more flavors. Like, why are you dipping? I've never heard of anyone taking their like old ass gum and like dip it in flavor. Like, you know what I mean? I've never heard that. That's so bad in Russia or in Ukraine that they just have to flavor their own gum. Like, fuck, let's give them some flavored gum, guys, and make it inexpensive so they can buy more than one pack. So when it runs out, you can get some more.
All right, you heard it here. We're raising gum for Ukraine.
Yeah, raising gum for Ukraine. Doing our part. Doing our part in the front lines. That'd be hilarious. We should make a button like that. Donate a pack of gum to the Ukrainian soldiers. We just
that'd be really funny, especially if it went viral and they just kept getting fucking gum. Like, what is this?
We can't hide anymore. The Russians keep finding us because it's shaking in our pockets as we walk. like little gum tins.
Yeah, they're blowing bubbles.
Yeah, pop. Oh, you're gonna get us killed, Vlad.
Well, we could actually give them exploding gum and they could like give it to the Russian soldiers and be like a peace offering and be like, here you go, share my gum, and then just blow their faces off.
That'd be interesting too. Imagine like a bunch of Russians just like, yeah, you just see the front line, all a bunch of heads explode because they just popped in a gum. Bam, 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 bam. What's going on?
Okay, so I guess we need two buttons.
Yeah. One's for exploding gum, which Christy's in charge of that. I'll be in charge of the normal gum because that's easy.
Okay, so this is our last one and it's my favorite one.
Okay, good.
We're going to head over to Trinidad. This one's
a little different. No Tobago, just Trinidad.
Port of Spain, Trinidad.
I'm just being a jackass.
All right, so this story is a little bit different in that 31-year-old John O'Brien's death was very much intentional, but he went through some Herculean trials to get there. This one's very Sky King. So John was on vacation from America in Port of Spain, Trinidad in January of 1990 when he decided it was time to meet his maker.
Nice.
Completely in the nude, John scaled two walls of barbed wire at the top. Oh. To get to the tarmac of the Piarco International Airport.
Just bring wire clippers with you, man. Nope. Like, Oh, nude naked. I've been stuck in fucking barbed wire. It's not good. Nude? It's not good at all. Not nude. No fucking way. No, I can't even imagine the fucking chunks of skin that would rip off. I ripped a lot of shirts though. I fucking jumped over a couple. I'm not going to tell you where, but a couple times, and the shirt didn't make it past when I came back. I had to rip it off like a home topless because it was fucking gone. Oh, it gives me the creeps just thinking about it. Anyway, sorry, keep going. He wanted to kill himself, and he got nude, scaled a fence.
Two.
So he's heading to the tarmac.
Two walls with barbed wire at the top so that he could get to the tarmac of the Piarco International Airport. When he arrived, he attacked four airport security guards, incapacitating them with his naked power.
Ow! Anyways, okay.
Talk about cockfighting.
Is it Chuck Norris? I'm so hard right now. Just cocks them out.
They'd be weird about it. They're like, I don't want to fight the naked guy. I don't want to touch him.
Yeah.
Naked guy would be like, come here, baby. Let's go.
Imagine being that homophobic that you couldn't fight a naked guy. Like, you just like, I'll get knocked out. I don't give a fuck. I'm not
that homophobic. I'm that homophobic where fighting a naked guy is my life.
It's Trinidad as well. And they have some of the most toughest laws against homosexuality.
Oh, yeah. I don't want to go to jail. I don't want to go to jail. So, yeah.
Yeah. I touched a naked man. I'm going to go to prison. I'd rather just.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. They didn't. He fought them. He fought and incapacitated all four of them nude.
Oh, okay. God, I wish I could have seen that.
Yeah.
So far, this guy's impressive, actually. Now, before I was like, he's an idiot because he climbed, because I've experienced that. But now that he fought, dude, this reminds me of, actually, where's my background? Of Vigo. Oh,
God. I should have called it Vigo Mortensen's butthole. Or no, the sidekick.
Yeah.
I'm ready.
Okay, so he fights nude and then he steals their vehicle, which he then rams into the side of a British Airways 747 that was ready for takeoff.
Okay.
Onlooker said that John traveled around 150 meters further from the side of the plane before the vehicle came to a stop. John then emerged from the wreckage through the top of the vehicle, which had been ripped open by the impact.
I'm king of the world. Big dick swinging because he has a huge dick, this guy, guaranteed.
Oh, 100%.
Yeah, that's a fucking hang low fucking knee knocker.
Had.
Anyway, he comes out the top of the vehicle that had been ripped off, slides his hand along a pile of grease, rubs it on his bleeding shoulder.
That'll fix it.
And then sprinted full speed back to the airplane and, in an absolutely mystifying display, pun intended, hurls himself into the engine.
Oh, okay. I thought he was going to run back and beat the shit out of it with his bare hands, like the naked monster he is. He just beat the shit out of a 747, just punched it right out, knocked out that fucker. No, jumps in the engine. Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
I wonder what everyone was thinking. Oh, a plane delay again. Fuck.
Everyone in the plane could see this.
Yeah, I know.
Wow.
This nude man rubbing grease on his bleeding shoulder and then sprinting at the airplane.
Is a 747 big enough to just miss you at the end, or does it blow up the engine?
Oh, no, dude. He was fucking chom.
Yeah, so it didn't even fuck with the plane, probably. They probably just need to hose it down. Yeah, okay, well. Hey, man, honestly, out of all the ways we were just talking about, like, killing ourselves, that's one of the better ones. You're just instantly dead. You know what I mean? Like, probably the best one would be like someone just shoot me in the back of the head. Like, I'm done. I wouldn't even know what's coming. Just tip, click clacking right here. And you just see blood hit here. That'd be the end of the episode. Like, for you guys, you'd be like, whoa, I would be happy with that. Don't get mad at whoever did it. That's how I want to die. You know what I mean? Unless it's tomorrow when I'm 75 doing this show. Sure. But.
Oscar's going to inherit it. It's going to be Oscar and Jack.
Oh, yeah, good. Perfect. Take it away. I think Molly's more the one that would inherit it from my side.
Molly and Jack are really close in age. Maybe they'll fall in love.
Mm.
Aww.
Let's change that. They will fall in love.
Aw, so cute. Jack's a gentleman.
There you go. Yes. Molly's a handful. So That sounds like the perfect guy. There's gonna have to be a big gentleman.
He's used to people who are a lot. So
yeah, perfect.
Yeah, so I don't want to make fun of John. He chose this method to end his life, and this unfortunately is a little bit of a downer. He was reportedly diagnosed with a debilitating medical condition, and he was unable to afford the medication to treat it in America.
Aww,
so he decided to go out on his own terms. So fuck you, America.
And you know what? You know what? Those fucking guards should be embarrassed of themselves. Airport security should be embarrassed. This guy, it was ripe to do it. You can do it. And if that's the way you want to go, I applaud you.
Me too.
I'm sorry the chicken does get Bush of the Week, but you get like partial landing strip. He's got the landing strip of the week.
Yeah.
I can't think of a good alliteration for landing strip, but it's the landing strip of whatever it is.
Amazing.
But what's his name again?
John
O'Brien.
Fly high, John O'Brien.
You go, John O'Brien.
You, John O'Brien. I look up to you. Man like you. That's ballsy, you know? I'm hoping to make it to my old age, though. Like, but if I got something super fucked up with me and I couldn't do anything, I'd probably end it too.
No, he was younger than you are.
But I mean, if I would have got some sort of terminal cancer, I wouldn't sit in the fucking bed and just wait to die. I don't know if I'd go jump into an engine of a plane. Like, I'm not that badass.
I might in Trinidad.
I guess so. Did you do the vacation first?
Yes.
Oh, good. See, that's kind of the...
Actually, he kind of went a little bit crazy and tried to strangle one of his friends first, but...
Well, that's what you do. When you fight, you get terminal disease, you go kill your enemies, then kill yourself. That's just the... Yeah. The three things you do, right? That's right. How that order goes. You're not going to let your... If you're not dying before your enemies, I'll die. My enemies die first.
Right. No,
I got nothing to lose.
I'm in agreement. Fuck that guy. Yep. Whoever he was that he tried to strangle.
You want to come to Trinidad with me, enemy? Sure, we're friends. Yeah, sure, we are enemy.
Let's go on a holiday.
That is my last story for you guys. I thought that's a good one. Good for him. I've heard so much about the Sky King. I want some more props for John O'Brien, because fuck yeah, dude.
John O'B's like, that's not even a Darwin Award. That is like an Einstein Award.
Yeah, I love it.
That's like a smart way to do it. I would have never thought of like mystifying myself in a plane engine with being, but it's good. It's a good way to go. Like, fuck it, you're done. And plus you got to have a cool fight scene. You got to rub oil all over his body, grease himself up, you know? Run a car, like fucking rip the top off a car. This is sexy. This is sexy.
He really took himself out in the action sequence of a movie. He was like, I've always wanted to be in a movie. Yep.
Yeah, beat up a bunch of like foreign people. Like, you know what I mean? Like he went in like as if they were like terrorists or something, you know? Just like
exactly.
Yeah. This is like John McClane with a suicide at the end. That's a Die Hard reference.
Die Hard 18. Yeah. Die for real.
Yeah. Die Hard. Die Misty. Yeah. Oh, good for him. Good for that guy. That is fantastic. Yeah. That's an Einstein Award. Landing strip lover. I'll think of something eventually. The chicken gets Bush of the Week. I'm sorry.
The rooster does get Bush of the Week. Yeah,
the rooster I agree. Does.
Yeah. I agree. But his bush is up there for sure. It's a handsome bush. Been seen by many people. Yeah. Before his death.
Including an airport full of homophobic Trinidadians.
I don't know, man. I feel like they would have been like, go, man, go. Like, you know, like Chariots of Fire is playing as he runs headfirst into the engine.
And you just have like two runways over, just the air traffic controller. Like, what's that? I'm like, oh, it's red. Just wiping their brow.
I thought it was raining.
That would be kind of anticlimactic, though, depending how big the engine is, because he's like sprinting at it, and then it's just like,
it's a good one.
And he's gone.
I don't know how like a good song that just ends like that, like a boom, and you just perfect. Like, did he have headphones in? Oh, imagine the soundtrack for that. That'd be cool.
Flight of the Valkyries. Yeah. He's just fucking ripping.
The whole time.
Yeah, that's a good one. Anyway, that's all my stories. Nice, easy one for today.
Amazing.
It's good. We need to have a few light ones, like the... Well, you guys thought it was fucking heartwarming the last one we did, but I
with the dolls?
Yeah.
He took good care of those children.
Hey, Alexa, play me my favorite song.
He took such good care of them, though. Hey, what's up, you guys?
Hey.
Hiro.
We're back.
We're God, back.
It felt good. God, it felt good to rejuvenate myself. I'm not going to lie.
We did. We took a break after Chris Chan. We were all... We needed some showers, really long ones. I just got out, actually, 2 hours ago.
I needed some chemo to get rid of the chancer.
I needed some therapy to get rid of some of the chancer. The chancer. Mm-hmm.
I read more Chris Chan. And
I got further into Chris Chan.
I got digital copies of Sadachu, got myself one of his custom made medallions. Yeah, I really threw myself into that. Ugh. I am one with Chris Chan now.
No, it's good though. We needed a break. You know, we did 70 some episodes in like a year and a half, and we didn't really we took a break at Christmas, I think.
Yeah, like, you know? 2 weeks. We took 2 weeks at one point, and
that's it.
Ripping, but we have a lot of content out there now, and now we're into season 4. Holy shit.
Yeah.
25 episodes a season. We're on season 4 now.
Wow.
Oh, that's how you're doing it. I was like, what does that even mean? But cool. I'm cool with it. That's 25 a season.
Other podcasts do seasons. I have no idea what it means, but by God, if we're not going to do it too.
Quarter a season. You have a season, I have a season. Fuck you.
Exactly. That's where I'm at right now. We're not going to make any changes to our cover art or anything like that to change the season. We will be making some changes to our merchandise art and some of our promotional art, but that has nothing to do with season 4. As some of you probably noticed, Tally hasn't been on the show in a little while, and so we wanted to be transparent with you and just let you know that Tally has decided to move on from Unethical Podcast. And we're going to miss her a lot. We're still supporting her like crazy, and we still love her.
Yeah, this isn't sad. This is amazing. This is a great thing. Mm-hmm. She's good. Murder Savvy Podcast. If you guys listen to it, wicked.
Oh, for sure. She's got a few episodes out. Go check out Murder Savvy Podcast. I listen to it on Spotify.
Perfect. You know what I mean? She's going to do her thing. We're still doing our thing. So everyone's still buddies. So don't worry about that. I've gotten a couple messages. We're all still pals. Don't worry about that. We're just doing our own thing now. So
we didn't kill her for a story. She's still alive.
We didn't kill her for a story so far.
Yeah.
Well, that's true.
No, but you guys are fucking us. If Tally ends up dead, we're all in trouble.
I don't know, man. Only one of us has a big beard.
Oh, fuck. Yeah, I'm a dude too. I'm statistically the one to have done it. God damn it.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
All the best to Tally, you know what I mean? Check that out. Mm-hmm. Have fun with that.
All the best to Tally. We're all friends, and she's following her passions over there, so you can go and listen to the things that she's passionate about. I believe we've got, what do we got, Blackbeard over there. She's talking about pirates. She's having a lot of fun over there. She's producing a good show, and I can't wait for more episodes.
Yeah, me neither. What other things are happening in season 4? We got any new art?
Yeah, we're going to be releasing some new art. Our merch store has moved. We're going to be launching that pretty soon with some updated art and some new stuff. Keep your eyes peeled for that. We've got some.
Oh, yeah. I'm excited. I'm excited for some of the art. I forgot. Oh, yeah. Come on!
Get out of here!
Get off my lawn!
Stop playing your guitar!
Yes. that's cool, too. And then
people will be hearing more of Bo and more of Sarah, or Dingus, as we like to call her. So,
Miss Dingus, she's going to be bringing us lots of stories, and she always has such great stories about such random things, and it's my favorite thing to have her come and host.
Yeah, for sure. Mm-hmm.
And new guests, fun new guests this season we're going to be bringing on.
For sure.
As usual, the outstanding agreement is if you want to come on the show, let us know. Because we want to have you guys on the show. There are some holdouts in our regular listenership that we won't announce right here, but you know who you are. Get your butts on the show. We're waiting for you.
Yeah. What else? There's some more. Oh, we're going to be changing Patreon a little bit, which is fine. We'll make that announcement on the thing, on the Facebook page or wherever else. I'm not really going to tell you what we're doing, but it's for the best for one. It'll be wicked. You guys will enjoy what we're doing. So that'll be good. So go if you haven't joined our Facebook page or follow us on Instagram or anything like that, go find us on Unethicult on Facebook, the official Unethical Facebook group. And then we're at Unethical for Insta.
Unethical Podcast.
Unethical Podcast, that's right. So check all that stuff out, and then you can get more updates on our Patreon, our new store that Celeste was talking about. All that stuff gets posted there. I got nothing else. You guys got anything else?
No, leave ratings, reviews. Our schedule is going to be changing a little bit coming up too. We're going to be switching to an alternating two-week schedule with our brother show, Private Dicks.
Woo-hoo. Yeah. No, that's going to happen soon too. And please leave the ratings, leave the reviews for sure. And one thing that I did forget, and how could I? I want to thank everyone who's been sticking around listening to us for so long. This is wicked.
Yeah.
I'm super happy. You guys are what make me want to do this show more and more. You know what I mean? So the more you guys listen, the more you guys sharing and spreading this amongst your friends, the better. I love that you guys are all into this. And I'll continue to keep doing it as long as you guys continue to listen. So thank you very, 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 very much from the bottom of my heart. I appreciate it. Honestly, I really do.
We all do.
Usually I'm a jackass.
Huge bushes.
I've become really close friends with a lot of our listeners just through messaging them all the time.
Yeah, me too.
I want to make more friends and keep those friends that I've made. And we couldn't do that without this podcast. So we are so, so grateful.
Yeah,
absolutely. Yeah.
So go out there and into the world, listening audience, and you get yourself a comb and you fluff that bush out and show it to everyone you see, except for kids. You'll get in trouble.
Anyone over 18, please
verify the age first.
Yes.
Yeah.
Go show that bush. Go fuck it. Be proud of your bush. It's beautiful. Mm-hmm. No mange in your bush.
No mange.
No
big,
mange.
Beautiful mangeless bush. That is all right. A hell of a shrubbery.
We love you all.
Hail Satan.
All right, guys. Thank you so much for listening to another episode of Unethical Podcast. If you're not in the Facebook group, stop being such a silly goose and come find us at Unethicult, the official Unethical Podcast group. If you find you just can't handle the anticipation until the next episode, then it's a great time to join our Patreon, where we have a ton of extra unethical content, and of course, our brother podcast, Private Dicks. And in case you didn't hear the good news, Private Dicks is now Public Dicks. Every 2 weeks, an episode of Season 1 will drop wherever you eat your podcasts, and our lucky Patreon patrons are literally living in the future, listening to new episodes from Season 2. On the fence about it? Have a listen to the trailer and see what you think. If you've got a case, big or small, give the Private Dicks a call. And yes, the phone number is real. Enjoy!
Have you got a mystery that needs solving?
Where is Amelia Earhart?
We know.
Who the hell was D.B. Cooper?
Bah, easy.
Bermuda Triangle?
Probably solve that one next.
Here at Private Dicks, we guarantee a mystery solved every episode.
That's with a capital G.
Every second Friday, the Private Dicks take a client, record their session, and solve the world's greatest mysteries.
One by one.
Private Dicks solve them, no problem. God, I love just crushing mysteries. Search up Private Dicks on your favorite podcatcher and you can solve a mystery too.
The mystery of what's your favorite podcast?
It's Private Dicks. Another one solved.
If you have a mystery to be solved, call 1-855-PRVT-DIX. That's 1-855-PRIVATE-DICKS.
Call 1-855-PRIVATE-DICKS and leave us the rundown of the case. Maybe the Dicks will solve it.
855-PRIVATE-DICKS.
I'm straight when it comes to humans, but fucking gay for more people.